and don't. Thank you. Often known as a dirty bomb or an RDD or a device that simply doesn't explode but simply exposes people to a lot of things, an RED. Those are all very much of concern. Some of the nucleides that are particularly concerned are listed there. So that is framing what I'm talking about when I talk about nuclear threat, mostly on the nuclear side, but certainly all those things are concerned. All right, let's see what happened with this poll. I want to share with you what we got. And you can see we are mostly graduate students, few postdoc staff, faculty, 20% associated with NSSC, and 33% are fabulous. Well, I hope we have more than that by the end of the meeting. Let us go on and talk about the nuclear threat personally. I'm very curious to see how likely you think it is that there will be a malicious nuclear detonation in your lifetime. So let's do a poll here. It's a very simple poll.
What is a malicious nuclear detonation?
Not like an accident.
Okay.
Someone on purpose is trying to cause damage or harm. Good question. And there's an age factor here, obviously, right? So it's less likely in my lifetime than in Preston's. But that's because I've got less left. But anyway, I'm curious to think, to see what people think. And I appreciate you putting in your votes there. I'll give people a few more seconds because there's a follow-up to this. And I think this helps stages the thing. There's no difference between me and say Preston, who, for those of you know, Preston Wiederson's working with me. And he's a first year graduate student. And in a very different perspective, I grew up during the Cold War, very much in the duck and cover type of situation. And we were often living with very much concern that this could happen at any time. And a little bit different today, but let's see. I'm gonna end this poll so we can show these results. Kind of interesting. Half people think it's not likely, but 30% thought it was 50-50, and 20% thought likely. So that's an interesting spread. Certainly not everybody is in agreement, and that's one of the problems with this. Even if you think it's not likely, the consequence is so severe that it's something that we need to be concerned about. So let's ask another question, which is, how many casualties would result from nuclear detonation in a crowded city?
What's the yield of the nuclear detonation?
I'm just imagining, you know, 10, 20 kilotons, not something huge.
Nothing huge.
by nuclear standards, but these are the kind of things we worry a lot about. And I put things in terms of things that are pretty tangible to us these days. And I've been doing this question for a while now, and of course, the COVID-19 reference keeps changing. But it used to be startling to anybody that we could have something that would be as devastating as 9/11. And now we're in a situation where, you know, we have obviously this horrible situation with the large number of deaths across the country. But in COVID-19, remember, nuclear detonation would be very dramatic because it would all be concentrated in one place with a huge amount of physical destruction as well. But those are all on your terms. So I appreciate people putting in their votes. I would say, is that closing? I can do that. Yeah, I can do that. Okay, so let's see what people said. We'll share these results. And what we find is nobody thought it was gonna be less than 9/11. That was about 3,000 people. Everybody agreed more than. I didn't want to write more than this and less than that. It was sort of implied. More than COVID-19 in a large city, or more than COVID-19 in all the US, now at 200,000. Combined death toll in Hiroshima and Nagasaki was certainly more than 200,000. Well, people argue about that, but I think we're in that ballpark and people seem to agree. So let's move on and talk about some of the science here. So, what does nuclear threat detonation require? Sensitivity, obviously, but also discrimination is a key factor of what we do. And this is why machine learning becomes so important. So the basic problem is the signals are small. Yes, we're looking for radioactive material and it is radioactive and it produces a signal, but it gets very attenuated from shielding materials, even from air, certainly from distance. And the emission rates are not that high compared to, say, a highly radioactive source. Plutonium, uranium are not super bright in terms of the sources we're looking for. But the other factors on the right side there, the noise. The noise can be very big. Background variations are large. Nuisance sources are very common, both medical sources, industrial sources, and what we call NORM, naturally occurring radioactive material. And these things all can cause a lot of confusion. So our goal is, number one, to detect on the left, and number two, to discriminate. So how do we do this? We have several approaches that we use in our technologies. First, we do spectral analysis, where we determine the energy spectrum of the gamma rays, or even the neutrons in some cases. That can tell us a lot. We do spatial analysis, how things are spread out. For example, these naturally occurring radioactive materials, or NORM, are generally big loads of material to produce a strong radioactive signature. But it's not all coming from a point source. It's distributed or spread out. We can see that. Temporal analysis can tell us things about how things are moving around. Also, the fission itself produces correlated measurements, which can be used to determine a unique signature. I'm focusing on the magic ring here, which is data fusion. Optimally combine the measurements, rule them, find them, bring them all, and into one threat metric, we bind them. And that's what we're really after here. And the machine learning is a tool to do that through very disparate types of stuff. Okay, we got another poll. So we talked about that. We're going to talk about how a threat might come to us. So what do you think is the most likely pathway for a nuclear threat to the US? And I have to say, I'm not sure this will allow me to do more than one. I think it's actually set to do only one, but we'll get a distribution if everybody puts their favorite. And there's no right or wrong answers here. This is sort of an opinion poll, as it were. So yeah, my intent was to have a couple there, but that's okay. It'll work. So as I mentioned, the initial concern that when we were kids and stuff was a missile or bomber attack, and that's still obviously a concern. But there are lots of other pathways from which something could come, including air cargo, general aviation, cargo ships, small vessels, all these sorts of things. So take a look through the whole list, see what you think. It's more fun to put a couple there. And yeah, pretty good vote tally here. Let's take a look. And what do we get? Well, we got a great distribution here. Let's say the winner was constructed or stolen in the US. Very interesting. Very interesting. That is certainly a concern. Missile or bomber attack certainly keeps us up at night as well. Cargo container, cargo ship number was certainly very high on the list. And I'd say the loser was general aviation and even less so than bicycle, because we have some good kidders here. Bicycle seems extremely unlikely, and that's actually an important factor. Okay, so here's a map of the world. Showing a projection of some of what goes on to try to stop nuclear threat in terms of where we're doing our nuclear threat detection. We go all the way from the source, which is shown here by these sort of red circles. There's some examples of some of the sources where nuclear material can come from, where we know there's nuclear material of concern. And all the way to the target, obviously we're concerned about the US. And there are pathways that we try to intercept close to the source, where the source might be leaving the Eurasian continent or Africa with foreign ports and borders. And then there's protection around the perimeter of the US and the US seaports. And then we have protections inside and things we're concerned about with the wide, with an area detection. So those are all pathways that we concern ourselves with, and we try to cover as many of those as we can. I'm gonna, for descriptive purposes here, focus on three nuclear detection applications. The first is nuclear search. We're simply asking, where is it? The second is monitoring or diagnostics. We're asking, what is it? So we get a radioactive signature and we want to know, is this really a threat? And if it is a threat, exactly what's inside? Comes up a lot. And the last one I put up there for fun is nuclear forensics. Where did it come from? So these are the three applications I'm going to consider. And we're going to do this by looking at some film clips, hopefully, if the audio video comes through with all these people on. So bear with us and see what happens. We're going to look at where is it, and there'll be a poll after this, of course. You've seen I love my polls. And so think about if you can recognize where this comes from. Let's see how it works. This is my favorite part. You have to make detectors that you can do that with. I've got one that looks just like that.
We got one.
It's not going to see it from that far away.
Is it just me, Simon, or are we missing the video?
I'm seeing anybody else missing it.
Sir?
Yeah.
We got one intact.
I can see it.
Okay. In the end, we got one intact. Hopefully at least people can enjoy the audio. I talked over it a little bit. So the question here we're gonna ask obviously is what movie this is, but I realize it's a bit sectioned off. It's not the main actors. So I thought I'd give you a little hint before I make you guess here. Because there's a really wonderful sequence, which I think is extremely good advice that I think we should all give our students. You recognize him? Here's what he has to say.
Would you mind not shooting at the thermonuclear weapons?
I think that's very good advice. Please don't shoot at the thermonuclear weapons. All right, let's launch the poll here. There we go. What do you think it is? Is it the movie War Games? Is it Mission Impossible? Is it Phenomenon? Is it Broken Arrow? Or is it Face Off? People are voting. Excellent. So there's a good photo. If you haven't seen this movie, it's actually a lot of fun and it's an interesting concept. Obviously, there's a lot of very silly things from a science point of view, but in terms of a scenario, it does play out a scenario of concern. And so certainly you could look that up. I'm gonna give people a few more seconds in here to vote and we'll see what we did. I think so far it looks like people have an excellent, got it right, we'll share the results. And sure enough, the largest number of votes goes to Broken Arrow. Broken Arrow is a term referring to a lost nuclear weapon, good guesses there. A lot of these are real movies, and I encourage you to check them all out because they'll all have relevant and interesting things associated with them. So here we are. And you see here, 1996. All right, let's move on. That was a fictional helicopter with a detector. Here's a real helicopter with a detector. This is the DOE's Aerial Measuring System, or AMS. And our friends at the NSSC, or associate of the NSSC, got permission for them to come and do some measurements right here in the Bay Area, which was very cool. And I have some results from that. First of all, this is the gamma ray spectra collected by that instrument there. It's a huge array of sodium iodide detectors. And what you see is the signature that you get over land is significantly more intense, about 5 times more intensity, and a very different spectral signature than what you get over water. And that's sort of averaged over a bunch of measurements. And that becomes very, very important factor for us to try to improve sensitivity of the system using our techniques. So what we see here on the left is the raw data. And with the raw data, for those of you who don't recognize where you are, this is the Berkeley Marina right down in there, and the little Emeryville Marina there. Here's the Oakland Estuary. It's dark because it's over water. They're scanning back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. This little dark spot is Lake Merritt. And up in here, move this out of my way. Go, there we go. There's some of the Berkeley Hills, Indian Rock and whatnot, and their campus is right up in there. That's where you are. This big bright spot here is well known to me. That's near 30th and Telegraph in Oakland. Which is sometimes called Pill Hill. Actually, when I looked in detail, that's right where my wife's office used to be. What does my wife do? She's a physician. And sure enough, that's a medical x-ray facility. So on the left is the raw data, and you can see we're dominated by all these fluctuations. But on the right, we've processed it with a spectral anomaly detection, which looks for things that are different than background after training on all the things that the background are. And what you see is very dramatic here is that the original bright source we saw over there in 30th and Telegraph is still there. But now we're beginning to see some other things. We see a medical source over here, someone headed down into the Webster Tunnel, somebody headed across up here. There's one showing up there. And there's a little dot up here, which it turns out is Echeverry Hall. So we have enough sensitivity to see whatever source was there. This shows another view of that same thing. This is a time sequence on the top. And you can see the thing going up and down and up and down as they're rastering back and forth, flying back and forth across. They flew this thing at like what? Less than 1,000 feet or something. It was just 1,000 feet. I think they got permission to go to 500. Maybe somebody remembers offhand. But anyway, you can see the very bright source where they're going back and forth over that 30th and Telegraph spot, but there's no way you can see any of those sources there. After we do this spectral anomaly detection, we get a very, very flat response except for these things that are very likely real sources. So that is a great result, but it can be better. Why? Because that is anomaly detection. All we're doing is separating sources from background. So it does not separate threats from benign sources, and nuisance sources are fairly common. You saw there were a bunch of sources that we found there after we did that spectral anomaly detection. But left like that, how would we know if those are dangerous or not? So I differentiate that from threat detection over here, where we separate the threat from other sources in background. Matching the threat sources can increase sensitivity. But to do that, we need to know what the threat's gonna look like. How do we know? The threat could be anything. It could be many, many different fissile materials or fissile materials combinations. It could be in various shielding conditions, and all those change the signatures. So one of the things that we did was we put together a capability to augment our data. So I've got to bring up another poll here, of course. This actually is kind of a test for those that have familiarity. So there's a bunch of options here. What I'm asking is what radiation source are typically found in large measurement sets. In other words, if I just go out there with a detector and drive it around or walk around with it for days and days and days, I'm going to see radioactive sources because they're everywhere. And the question is here, which type of sources are typically found in these large measurement data sources? Do we find medical sources? Do we find industrial sources? Do we find naturally occurring radioactive material or norm? Contamination, how common is that going to be to see? Radiological threats, like dirty bombs. Uranium and or plutonium, how often do those come up? Or nuclear weapons. And I believe there should be a check all that you want. So here, I'll go try it myself. I've got second screen running here. And see what we get. Can correct it, submit it. There we go. A little more complicated, take your time. And the point of this is that not all these things are equally likely. Yes, we see norm quite a bit. I see a lot of people are recognizing that, and medical sources are extremely common. Industrial sources, you'd be surprised. Here we are in our nuclear-free zone, but that doesn't mean if you don't have a license, whatever, you if you need a Troxler density gauge, I'm sure you get permission to do that. And they show up quite a bit. Contamination, believe it or not, when we're monitoring things at ports and stuff, we see that quite common. We've gotten, pretty common things would be like cast iron, big cast iron sheets, portal access, hole access covers, and those kinds of things. Tractors. One time we had saw a big load of tractors. Anyway, thank you very much for there. You can see that the first three, everybody agrees, are pretty common. The last one's less so. But the point is, actually be surprised how often we do see uranium fuel rods, uranium shipments, dirty laundry. Plutonium actually shows up in that sometimes when we get contaminated laundry. But the point is, although we got 9% and 5% saying radiological and nuclear weapons. In truth, we never see those. Thank goodness, right? Nobody's running around with nuclear weapons. So we don't see those in the data sets. And that's why it's so important that we have a capability to estimate what those are going to look like. So data engineering is what we often call this when we do augmentation or changes to the data, and specifically for nuclear threat detection. So machine learning really requires sample data from a full range of all the possible measurements. If you train a machine learning to only look for what's in the data already, you'll never find the things we really want to find that we're concerned about because they're not in the data. So you have to do something. And you can't, sure, we can measure a few objects of concern in special conditions, but you're never going to get all the possible things. So what we do is we analyze the data to determine what's missing. We select samples to augment it with, and then we take real measurements with all the nasty nitty-gritty changes of real measurement and all the noise, and we add by injection, we add additional counts to what you would have seen from these sources. And we've created this unclassified, we call LNL surrogate nuclear models, or LSNM. So it has the same acronym, SNM, but these are not for special nuclear material. It's surrogate nuclear models. And it's based on this generalized model of smuggled material I showed you before, with a object that could be hidden inside all these different layers of material. We actualize it for calculation purposes through a one-dimensional model with a bunch of spheres, which works out pretty well. And we create fissile material models like this. We also do non-fissile material, so we have a whole bunch of different things that we might see. And that tends to be a very powerful tool. This just shows you how we construct some of these layers. They're all random. That's what keeps it completely unclassified. We have no bias on any of these things. We just say there's a fissile material. It could be any of these things listed in this tree here, different kinds of uranium and plutonium, even some more exotic materials. We can have different kinds of shielding materials, high Z, mid Z, low Z. Those can all be there. They can some be there. There can be gaps and voids. All that's randomly chosen. And what we get from that is a huge distribution of signatures. And this is an amazing plot because it covers 10 orders of magnitude of the gamma ray leakage, as we call it, or the flux out into 4 pi. in the y-axis, and about 10 orders of magnitude in the neutrons on the other axis, on the x-axis. And you can see there's clustering going on there, big scattering all over the place, but you tend to get the more unshielded sources form a clustering of uranium on the left and plutonium on the right. And then below it, the more shielded things. The right has more neutrons, plutonium has more neutrons. But the point is, there's not one source you're looking for. We have thousands of possible signatures, and we use them all. We use them for training. We use them for testing. So it's a very powerful bit to show us, you know, what those sources might look like, so we can train up our system, and then we test to see what we could detect and what we might not. So I talked a bit about those aerial measurements. Another place where we're using, and we're actually now involving machine learning, is in this ubiquitous detector systems, such as what's called the Sigma program, where we want to have large numbers of detectors everywhere. Remember, one of the things we talked about early on is, where is this threat going to come from? It could be generated inside the country. If it's generated inside the country, well, none of these border protections is going to do us any good. So we want to be able to cover a large area to see if there's something there. And that means we need a lot of detectors. And a lot of detectors mean it's going to get expensive. And it means there's going to be a lot of false alarms. And that won't, neither of those is any good. So the Sigma program focused on those two factors. They put out a call to get detectors cheap. And this D3S, this handheld detector, is really amazing what it can do. Spectroscopic, hooks up to a cell phone, communicates, we got 10,000 of those. Very, very nice devices. We also repurposed some sodium iodides in the back of vehicles, as you see there, driving all around. And we also developed algorithms. Algorithms to reduce false alarms, algorithms to improve sensitivity. Next slide shows some of that more explicitly. On the left side, I'm showing the data fusion analysis we did, where you can see if you have a situation where you're passing by a source again and again, say on some route every day you go by, if you're only looking at individual detectors one at a time, you don't get any effect of that adding in, but you can get much more sensitivity if you do some kind of data fusion, which is what those different, those are different methods, and it shows different methods can have different effectiveness. On the right is where we're focusing right now, where we're using machine learning to try to reduce the number of false alarms. So in this case, the problem is we got all these detectors and they're not all perfect. They're not all working just the way they should be. They tend to slip and slide and the calibration changes and they get too hot, they get too cold, they delaminate a little bit, all kinds of things happen. You have lots of detectors, they're not going to be perfect. And so we need an algorithm that's going to go in there and try to figure out, use all the information together to figure out what is really a true concern of these detections that we get. First of all, is it a real detection? Is it just background? But then if it's really a detection, is it really a concern? Most of the time it's not. But we can't just assume that, it would be useless. So we need to detail. And we put all these factors together, do multiple analysis, put together through machine learning, and we can then classify it as to whether red as a red alert, got to act on it, or maybe green, it's just totally benign. And we can say, hey, the system is working. We're detecting things like we just showed, these norms, industrial, medical sources, those are all good. So very effective system, and we're going to move on. The next category is nuclear monitoring diagnostics. The black screen means what? There's a movie coming up. So be ready to answer the question. This one, well, let's just see. Hopefully you'll be able to see it. I'm sorry if you can't, but at least you could hear it.
He's got it all right. There's the core, explosive package. Electronics, tamper, batteries. Nice design, actually.
Is it armed?
Nope.
You certain?
Mm-hmm. It's all in sections.
There we go. Let's launch the poll. So it's all in sections. That's a good thing. I don't like to say too much about these pictures because it's just fictitious. And Let's just say that when I put a figure caption on it, I've learned to just say it's a X-ray radiograph of a suitcase, not try to speculate beyond there. I always thought it was interesting that the bones in the hands are as contrasty as the metal parts in the object. Anyway, it's a good movie recommendation, by the way. Kind of cute what goes on, and a bit far-fetched, but still something that you might be interested in. And this was just an example of a radiograph. Obviously, it doesn't quite work like that, but basically a portal situation where they're screening. So in this case, they know there's something there and they want to know what it is. And we have screening systems that use passive, that use the radiation coming out of the system, and screening systems like this that use radiography with gammas or even now neutrons to scan something and try to determine what's inside. And what's happening a lot now is each of those measurement modalities gives you different information, and machine learning is an excellent way to combine those together to try to determine what it was. So let's see. We have a couple options. Duck and Cover, Manhattan Project, Catch That Kid, Project X, Ready Player One, and War Games. And I appreciate everybody putting in your votes. And we'll share the results. And I see the most popular one, which is Catch That Kid and War Games. Both good movies. They remade as War Games too, and then they remade it recently, I think. But actually, that is not correct. It was a very young John Lithgow, if you happen to notice. The answer is, not surprisingly, the Manhattan Project, about a kid who does a science project of building a nuclear weapon. Well, so there it goes. I just want to show you that as an example of a monitoring situation. So we have a system using machine learning to improve detection at a monitoring situation. In this case, it's the Enhanced Radiological Nuclear Inspection and Evaluation, or ERNIE. And it uses machine learning to improve threat detection and operations. In particular, it reduces false alarms while improving threat sensitivity. And the way it works is we augment the measurements, again, with this injection I was just talking about. We do what we call feature extraction, where we look for key physical features and parameters, and then do data fusion. And we use vehicle motion, we use all kinds of information altogether. It works using all the data generated by the system, not just the intensity of the signal. It applies a random forest machine learning analysis to distinguish threats from non-threats. A random forest is a group of decision trees. Decision trees are a machine learning method that uses, instead of just saying one threshold, is it brighter than this or dimmer than this? Each of these trees is some feature. Some of them might be intensity. It might be brighter than this, but then it has to be spectrally a little bit to this. And then maybe it has to be wider, more distributed than that. And it goes through this tree and makes a decision, gives it a weight. We do a whole bunch of trees to give it a less biased estimate, and come out with a very sensitive system. We train it with about 160,000 scans that have all been, or many of them been augmented, and we learn about what a threat looks like. Its output, it gives an investigate score. It's the main thing. It says, how likely is this thing to be an actual threat of concern? It also estimates the location and gives the most likely classification as best it can. This is how we analyze data like this. It's a receiver operating characteristic, or ROC curve. We're looking at the true positives, or the fraction of test sources detected on this axis, on the y-axis, as a function of false alarms. You always, always, always need to look at both. And the other thing that's really a concern for those that are into these kinds of things, if you're doing nuclear threat detection and you want to make a ROC curve, on your false positive axis here, the fraction of vehicles alarm, how many alarms you're getting, you need to use a log scale, because we don't care about what's happening here at a 10% alarm rate, because 10% would be way too much. We don't care what's happening at a 1%, because that's too much. We're trying to get down to a 10th of a percent, which is actually what we do. We get pretty close to that. And we get more detections up here in the corners where you want to be, as high as possible here. So we get more detections with less false alarms. More detections, less false alarms. That's what we do. The machine learning is very effective at that. This system has been tested and tested and tested in months-long campaigns and shown to be very effective. It's now in operation at several US seaports, and that's expanding out. And where they've actually installed it, the alarm rates have dropped so much that they're no longer required to staff booths by each instrument and spend more time doing other security operations. We've also got development in progress for more seaports and for foreign seaports. So it's been a very effective system. And I have one last category I want to touch on, which is nuclear forensics. And that's where we ask the question, where did it come from? Now, we have two kinds of nuclear forensics. We have what we call pre-detonation nuclear forensics, and that's pretty common, where they find some nuclear material, some uranium, plutonium, or something, and they ask, hey, where did that come from? And try to figure out how it got out and about and how it was intercepted and all that. There's also what we call post-detonation nuclear forensics, where if a nuclear weapon were to go off, we'd want to know where did it come from and all about what how it was constructed and things like that. That's what I'm going to describe here. But first, I'm going to let a movie describe it.
I think this is about as far as we go. Our feet are sizzling. And I'm getting rammed to nearly the limit of our gear.
Okay, cut the rope and loose and get the hell out of here.
Roger that.
John Clark was in Haifa yesterday.
Wow, check out that gadolinium reading.
Yeah, the mass fraction is huge.
Okay, connect me to Dylan, will you? I'll hold.
There it is. Savannah River.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, what?
They always have that gadolinium problem. Hanford does it another way. They always generate too much promethium.
Hold on a second. Can you translate that into English for me?
This plutonium came from the DOE planet Savannah River, February of 68, from K reactor. You can even tell which part of K reactor.
Wait a minute, this is our plutonium?
Made in the USA.
All right. So this may be more familiar to people. I listed some in the series. If it wasn't obvious, that was Jack Ryan, of course, an earlier Jack Ryan. I believe he's going to be playing Batman soon, but that's another story. So yeah, put in your votes. oh my, people are being very clever here. I appreciate that. So yeah, again, another interesting, this one I would say actually, in terms of the scenario, it is absolutely terrifying. There's a lot of very realistic things, a lot of not very realistic things, we won't get into that, about the scenario. It's certainly something to be concerned about. So definitely worth checking out, especially if you're interested in areas of nuclear security. So, these are actually listed in the order that, at least some of these, the order that they were written in, I believe. I went back and did some research. All right, thank you all. Able to put in your votes. As you can see, people did very well. This is the sum of all fears. Hunt for Red October, Patriot Games, and Clear and Present Danger are all Jack Ryan stories as well. And of course, there's a TV series on Netflix. No, or was it Amazon Prime? I can't remember. Anyway, no, it's not War Games. War Games is a great movie, but that's something else. So thank you all very much. So sure enough, that's the sum of all fears from 2002. They analyzed this sample. They had to go there in the field. They had to go take out the debris and do all this. So what we're trying to do is use machine learning to do analysis, provide comprehensive analysis of nuclear forensics data with improved speed and accuracy And our basic idea is to try to infer the weapon's design and performance from that. You can get an idea of where it may have come from and quantify the uncertainties. One of the big powerful things I find about machine learning is we can use it to quantify the uncertainties, to help us learn to know what we don't know. And we use the same basic techniques we use in everything else. We do this physics-based models used to expand the measurement set. So it's augmentation. And then we use statistical analysis and other physics-based methods to look at features, minimize the noise, and normalize the instruments. And then we use machine learning to fuse the data together. And the way it works basically is if there were to be an explosion, and if there are measurements to collect the data would all be transmitted to our analysis. All these different types of data are concerned. The ones that are blue and green are relatively prompt. And from those, we feed those into the machine learning. Machine learning then is used to estimate the weapons design. That's sort of the basic idea. And what we found, it's kind of interesting. This was, you know, based on a lot of synthetic data, of course, but we wanted to show what the degeneracies were like. And what this is showing, this was a very fun thing because before I started the project, I made some plots to conceptualize what it might look like. And it looked a whole lot like this. And this is actually the end result. So what I'm showing here is different stages of the investigation. We have more and more information available. Initially, we have no information. And there are, in this case, 14 different subclasses. And they all have the same probability because they're all equally likely. But as data comes in, we get a different ones are more likely or less likely as we get more and more data. And you can see as more data comes in and more information gathers, we can get down to a very few number of subclasses to predict and pretty much cancel out all the others. Meanwhile, down here, we're looking at the uncertainty. So this is basically the how the likelihood they were quantifying the uncertainty here. And of course, we stand out with 50-50, but it goes up very quickly. And we can predict that it will continue to rise. We'll get more and more accurate, better recall or accuracy through the different stages. And that's what we wanted to show with that. All right. Appreciate everybody's attention. I want to just summarize now, talking about what we do here. So first of all, we talked about data augmentation. It's critical to applying machine learning for nuclear threat detection. The measurement data sets are usually incomplete and we need to add to it. We need to take advantage of the measurement sets because the real world has too many idiosyncrasies and odd things happening for us to actually synthetically produce it all. But if we very cleverly just augment it with this injection process, we can fill out the missing types and get a very good representative set. Physics-based feature extraction is critical to machine learning because we reduce the access of machine learning to the possible artifacts. In other words, we can protect our injection process just in case it's not perfect, so that we get good signals there, and then we enhance the signal to noise of the inputs. And then finally, we run the machine learning itself, which improves detection, fusing data from different measurement modalities, and distinguishing likely threats from benign materials. So that's what I have. I appreciate everybody's attention. I hope it was entertaining. I hope you learned about some good movies to watch as well. And I will take questions, either unmute yourself, or you could try the chat.
Thank you so much, Simon, for an excellent presentation. So if you have questions, you can enter them into the chat or you can just speak up. I'm gonna start. So you mentioned that you're using physics-based models here. Can you talk specifically about how you're integrating the physics-based models into the machine learning algorithm? And also if you can say more in the latter case about the input data that you're using.
Right, so the process is we start with measured, real measured data that has all the variations due to you know, the environment changing, the detector's not always working right, all those kinds of things. And then with the augmentation, we take our models, like I showed those surrogate nuclear models, which, you know, they produce perfect estimates of what it thinks it is, but our radiation transport is never perfect, so there's noise associated with that. But anyway, we take those signatures and we literally add it to the measured data with the appropriate Poisson statistics. So we add the noise in as well. So for a given, we calculate what the detector would have seen had that source been present, and then we augment the data so it looks like that source was present. And the way we use that in machine learning is we do that over and over and over again. We make this 160,000 things that it's trained on. Of those, like a third of them are have this synthetic added information into them. We train on some just as they are. We train on some with this augmentation so that the machine learning can learn. The other problem is there are sometimes sources in the real world, but we rarely know really what they were because they're just random. We just find them. With the machine learning, with this augmentation process, if I add a plutonium source into a spectrum, I know there was plutonium there. And so I can train my system to look for that. And then I use a slightly different technique when I'm testing it to say, okay, there should be plutonium there. Can you see it?
Are you using single source radiation detector data as input?
That's one of the inputs. So we often have multiple detectors. We often have gammas and neutrons. We have big detectors and small detectors. And we use other information too. One thing about machine learning is because we reduce everything to features, we don't have to worry so much about the physics of, well, what does it mean that I've got a fast vehicle versus a slow vehicle? I measure the velocity of the vehicle. I just take that in there. And then the machine learning can learn that, oh, fast vehicles are going to be very quick and short bumps, and slow vehicles are going to have longer things. It'll learn about that. So we can put those other measurement modalities, we call contextual sensors, in there. How far away is the source? What was it in? Those kinds of things.
So we have a question in the chat. Andrew Dong, do you have your mic working?
Yeah, I can ask it. So this is going back to like one of the first audience questions regarding the likely or unlikely of a malicious nuclear detonation within our lifetime. I was wondering, what is the threshold for likely and unlikely in this context? Because some people would say 10% is likely, and other would say 10% is unlikely.
So if you ever don't want to serve on a jury, just bring up a question like that. That is just like a reasonable doubt. What's in a reasonable doubt? Is that 90% or 99%? That's why I brought that up. I purposely asked that question that way because everybody has a different view of what likely means. That's really was part of the question, just to get a sense. It's there's no right or wrong answer there about what likely is. I would have said about 50% for my idea of likely.
I have a question.
Speak.
How do you know that your machine learning analysis is accurate without training your model with actual nuclear threat or nuclear detonations?
Okay, so when we talked about search and monitoring and stuff, that case where we're looking just the passive signatures of nuclear devices, we do have some actual measurements that we can cross-check against. And you remember I mentioned with Ernie that we actually ran they ran field tests where they ran all kinds of things through it, including some uranium and other things, and tested it that way. And so that was a great double check across our models and stuff. For the forensics capabilities where we're trying to determine what went on there, we're pretty much stuck with the models. And there's just a huge amount of work going on to try and baseline and make sure our models are as accurate as possible, given our conditions. It's a very difficult, difficult problem because all the real data we have was for, you know, explosions in the desert or, you know, over the atolls and in the Pacific. And we don't have data for what exactly happens when there's a detonation over other places like a populated city. So there's a lot of modeling that has to go on there, and you do the best you can.
Thank you.
So, that's great fun you can have looking for how to place detector systems.
Well, great. Thanks again, Simon. Oh, one final question from Carl Britt. Carl, is your mic active?
Mic check.
Yep, there you are.
Perfect. Thank you for the talk. I had two questions. One, how do you know if the data being used to train the detection algorithm is being augmented in the right direction? And two, is there any, you showed a plot on detection performance with respect to number of detectors included in the analysis. And I think it was with regards to data fusion, but I was wondering if there's been, the uncertainty has been quantified for those particular plots.
So those were detection plots. So they were set at a certain false alarm rate. So the question was, you know, how many of these threat sources could you detect? You know, they were all fixed at a given distance and such with multiple passes by detector. So we do have Monte Carlo analysis where we run it over again under slightly different conditions and get similar results in terms of uncertainties. We have had done definitely measurements like that where you look at the detection with a bunch of passbys, usually then just to quantify the sensitivity. You also asked, how do I know if the augmentation is in the right direction? Well, we're generally starting with things where there's no radioactive source present. As common as some of those benign sources are, they're still only there 5% of the time or less. So most of the data we collect when we're wandering around, there's no radioactivity other than the background. And we are using that and then adding these signatures to them.
Great, thank you so much. Thanks again for joining us. And we really appreciate the presentation.
I appreciate the chance to talk to people and answer these great questions.
So if people are interested in this type of research, there's opportunities to engage in this through the Nuclear Science and Security Consortium. So you can visit our website at nssc.berkeley.edu, and we can help put you into contact with Simon or other researchers at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory. So thank you again, Simon. Thank you all for joining us. Have a great evening.
Thank you. Great to see you all.